Good morning, YouTube. So I'm getting ready to hook up the remote control for this Takagi water heater. And here's the remote control wire. I couldn't use the one they supplied because it wasn't quite long enough. What I have to do in my situation, I ran the wire up through the power grommet. That's the only open hole in the bottom of the unit. And I run up there, up behind the unit, and then up through this hole in the garage ceiling here where the exhaust vent goes. And then I just go over the top of the roof, and then I drilled a hole up inside the one of the kitchen cabinets, and then drop the wire down essentially on the other side of the wall right there is where my remote is. One thing I noticed that was really strange when I first opened this box, this power supply and control module was actually sitting over here on the side. It was screwed in. There's two little tabs on the bottom of the module that fit into holes here, but the whole unit was off here to the side. But anyway, I got the power off, and let me hook up the two screw terminals, and I'll show you what that looks like here. Okay, so I have the two terminals wired in here, but what I wanted to do is check what sort of voltage is on there. I assume it's got to be AC because these terminals aren't polarized, and there's only two wires to the remote. So let me plug in the power here, and the cycling the valves on and off, it sounds like. So let's see if we'll try this. I've got it on AC volts. It's not AC. Let's see if it's DC volts. Maybe. Yeah, okay, it's DC volts. 14 volts. And I want to see if there's any sort of frequency on there. No. Huh. Wow. They probably have a bridge rectifier on the remote control, and then they probably send signals back over the power supply line, because there's literally two wires and they're not polarized. Anyway, let's go look at the remote here. I'll show you the other end of the wire. Okay, here we are in the kitchen. So I see a couple of blue LEDs, and there we go. So that's the other end of the wire. I ran it down through the ceiling into the cabinet and down along with my other solar power wires. Yeah, that's just exactly the same display as on the front of the unit. So let me go turn on a faucet here, and we'll see if the remote updates. Okay, I got the faucet on. There, the unit kicked on. So we got 1.1 gallons a minute, 120. So the input water is 67. The output should be, oh, okay, 121. I guess it's cooling down to the water temperature. Yeah, it does seem to be a rather slow data rate. I'll have to figure out how to do the temperature setting. But let's turn the water off. Okay, I guess to set the temperature, you've got to be in standby mode here, according to that, and then you do that. There we go. And I think, is that, yeah, 140 is the limit. I'll see if the hot water gets hotter here. So it's turned on, in use. And let's see here, we've got in, out. Yeah, look at that, jumps right up. And let's see if it's actually feels hotter here. Yeah, it's definitely hotter water. So that's how you can change the temperature. So, I don't know, for some reason this one doesn't beep. It says it's supposed to beep. Why I wanted to get the remote was so, for instance, if I run the dishwasher, I can bump this up to, say, 140, run the dishwasher, and then turn it back to whatever I use for normal hot water, 120. And then if I want to take a shower or a bath, I can just set this to maybe 100 or 105, and then just have strictly hot water at the temperature you want your shower to be. So instead of heating the water to 120 and then adding cold water to bring it down to 105, just heat the water to 105 to begin with. And then you don't have to worry about the temperature going up and down. If somebody turns on a sink or flushes a toilet, you have a nice constant hot water temperature. So that's why I got that one. So I looked up the energy consumption. Let's see if I can find that in the manual here. Yeah, here we go. Here's the, just to show you the electrical power here. They don't have it on their web page. You have to download the manual. Since mine's an indoor unit, I should never hit the freeze protection. I don't think it'll ever get below freezing in the garage. Standby power is 3.2 watts, and operating power is essentially 54 watts. So if you figure that out over a month, figuring 30 days, 720 hours, you've got about 2.2 kilowatt hours of standby and then however many hours of operation. So if you figure maybe 3 or 4 hours of the heater running over a month, you're looking at maybe 2.5 kilowatt hours. So it would cost something like 30 cents a month in electricity to run this heater. But then hopefully you will save on the gas bill. So I'm hoping I save more on gas than I spend in electricity. And then ultimately I want to power this water heater, at least the electric side, off my solar power inverter. The nice thing is I can handle a 3-watt load. So very easy to power this off of a solar power inverter. That will be a future project. First thing I wanted to do was get it installed and get the old heater out of there. So I think that looks pretty good. So I just wanted to show you the installation of the remote control. So if you're getting one of these units, it's the TM-RE42. And you have to get that specific unit. If you get the outdoor unit, the remote comes with it, but the indoor unit doesn't. The remote, I think, retails for about $120, but I found a seller on eBay that had them for $60. So I think what happens is maybe people that get the outdoor unit don't use the remote, and then they probably give them back to the plumbing company and they get resold. So if you're looking for one of these, definitely check on eBay. You'll save yourself $60. Yeah, there's your water heater remote control, the TM-RE42. It couldn't be easier to install. I mean, two wires and they're not polarized. I mean, it took me more time to run the wire up inside the cabinet and over and down into the heater than it did to hook it up. Just two wires on one end, two wires on the other end. And the thing you want to do is hook up these wires first and then connect the wires in the heater, because I used some two-conductor bell wire. And when you cut that, you're cutting both wires with the wire cutter. And if you had it hooked up to the water heater, you're going to be shorting out those two wires. So hook up this end first, because there's no power here, and then hook up the water heater last. So I did this before I turned on the camera here, but just a little tip. But anyway, I think that is working and I'm pretty much done. I've got a little more, got to do all the hot water pipe insulation. I got to measure for that, see how much insulation I need, and then I have to finish the intake plumbing. I got to order a pipe elbow so I can finish that up. But otherwise, I think this project is nearing completion. At least it's fully functional now. I just have, oh, the other thing I'll show you in a separate video is my condensate line. So yeah, if you have any questions, post that up in the comment section below. I'll put some videos over here on the side you might be interested in. And as always, thanks for watching.